Hello everybody on YouTube, it's Ashley Brock again, and I'll do a quick brief summary. I'm 33. I record audio books on Anchor, which then you can listen to on Spotify. If you look up Ashley E. Brock, you should see my first book. Its name's Grayson. You'll see a picture of my face, and then other times it's just a picture of a book. That's how you know you've got the right one. Eventually I'll probably add the links down below. If you liked books, this is a channel for you because I read books out loud. I'm a stay-at-home mom, I have two kids, and so sometimes you'll hear them in the background because I'm not a professional YouTuber, so therefore I don't have a soundproof studio, or time to do a soundproof studio. And you will see the ceiling above you, but you'll be able to hear the audiobooks because stupid YouTube won't let you download audio files, which I find ridiculous. Alright, so anyways, here we go. Sea Swept by Nora Roberts. Chapter 2. They came alone and in crowds to waken to bury Ray Quinn. He'd been more than a resident of the dot on the map known as St. Christopher's. He'd been teacher and friend and confidant. In years, when the oyster crop was lean, he'd helped organize fundraisers or had suddenly found dozens of odd jobs that needed to be done to tide the watermen over a hard winter. If a student was struggling, Ray found a way to carve out an extra hour for a one-on-one. His literature classes at the university had always been filled, and it was rare for one to forget Professor Quinn. He believed in community, and that belief had been both strong and supple in indeed, he had realized that most vital of humanities, he had touched lives. And he had raised three boys that no one had wanted into men. They had left his gravesite buried in flowers and tears, so when the whispering and wondering began, it was most often hushed quickly. Few wanted to hear any gossip that reflected poorly on Ray Quinn, or so they said, even as their ears twitched to catch the murmurs. Sexual scandals, adultery, illegitimate child, suicide. Ridiculous, impossible, most said so and meant it, but others leaned a bit closer to catch every whisper, knit their brows, and pass the rumor from lip to ear. Cam heard none of the whispers. His grief was so huge, so monstrous, he could barely hear his own black thoughts. When his mother had died, he'd handled it. He'd been prepared for it, had watched her suffer, and had prayed for it to end. This loss had been too quick, too arbitrary, and there was no cancer to blame it for it. There were too many people in the house, people who wanted to offer sympathy or share memories. He didn't want their memories, couldn't face them until he dealt with his own. He sat alone on the dock that he helped Ray repair a dozen times over the years. Beside him was the pretty 20-foot slope they all sailed in countless times. Cam remembered the rig Ray had had that first summer, a little sunfish, an aluminum catboat that had looked about as big as a cork to Cam. And how patiently Ray had taught him how to sail, how to handle the rigging, how to tack. The thrill, Cam thought now, of the first time Ray had let him handle the tiller. It had been a life-altering experience for a boy who'd grown up on hard streets. Salty air in his face, wind snapping the white canvas, the speed and freedom of gliding over water. But most of all, it had been the trust. Here, Ray had said, see what you can do with her. Maybe it had been that one moment on the hazy afternoon, when the leaves were so full and green and the sun already a white-hot ball behind the mist, that had turned the boy toward the man he was now. And Ray had done it with a grin. He heard the footsteps on the dock, but didn't turn. He continued to look out over the water as Philip stood beside him. Most everybody's gone. Good. Philip slipped his hand into his pockets. They came for Dad. He'd have appreciated it. Yeah. Tired, Cam pressed his fingers to his eyes. Let them drop.
He would have. I ran out of things to say and ways to say them.
Yeah. Though he made his living with clever words, Philip understood exactly. He took a moment to enjoy the silence. The breeze off the water had a bit of a bite. That was a relief after the crowded house, overheated with bodies.
Grace is cleaning up in the kitchen. Seth's giving her a hand. I think he's got a case on her. She looks good.
Cam struggled to shift his mind to someone else, anything else.
Hard to imagine her with a kid of her own. She's divorced, right?
A year or two ago. He took over right before little Aubrey was born.
Philip blew out of breath between his teeth. You got some things to deal with, Cam. Cam recognized that tone, and the tone meant it was time for business. Resentment bubbling up instantly.
I was thinking of taking a sail. There's a good wind today.
You can sail later. Cam turned his head, face blank.
I can sail now.
There's a rumor going around that Dad committed suicide. Cam's face went blank, then filled with red-hot rage.
What the fuck is this?
He demanded as he shot to his feet. There, Philip thought with dark satisfaction. That got your attention.
There's some speculation that he aimed for the pole. That's just pure bullshit. Who the hell's saying that?
It's going around, and some of it's rooting. It has to do with Seth.
What has to do with Seth?
Cam began to pace long, furious strides up and down the narrow dock.
What? Do you think he was crazy for taking the kid on? Hell, he was crazy for taking any of us on. What does that have to do with an accident?
There's some talk brewing that Seth is his son by blood. That stopped Cam dead in his tracks.
Mom couldn't have kids.
I know that. Fury pounded in his chest, a hammer on steel.
You're saying that he cheated on her? That he went off with some other woman and got a kid? Jesus Christ, Phil.
I'm not saying it. Cam stepped closer until they were face to face.
What the hell are you saying?
I'm telling you what I heard. Philip said evenly,
so we can deal with it. If you have any balls, you'd have decked whoever said it in their lying mouth.
Like you want to deck me now? Is that your way of handling it? Just beat on it until it goes away. With his own temper bumbling, Philip shoved Cam back an inch. He was my father too, goddammit. You were the first, but you weren't the only.
Then why the hell weren't you standing up for him instead of listening to the garbage? Afraid to get your hands dirty? Ruin your manicure? If you weren't such a damn pussy, you'd have...
Philip's fist shot out, caught Cam neatly on the jaw. There was enough force behind the punch to snap Cam's head back, send him staggering for a foot or two. But he regained his balance quickly enough, with eyes dark and eager enough.
Well then, come on.
Hot blood roaring in his head, Philip started to strip off his jacket. Attack came swiftly, quietly, and from behind. He barely had time to curse before he was sailing off the dock and into the water. Philip surfaced, spat, and shoved the wet air out of his face.
Son of a bitch. You son of a bitch.
Ethan had his thumbs tucked in his front pockets now and studied his brother's field trade work. Go off, he suggested mildly.
This suit is Hugo Boss.
Philip managed as he kicked toward the dock.
That don't mean shit to me.
Ethan glanced over at Cam.
Mean anything to you?
Means he's gonna have a hell of a dry cleaning bill.
You too. Ethan set us up Cam off the dock. This isn't the time or place to go punching each other. So when the pair of you haul your butts out and dry off, we'll talk this through. I sent Seth on with Grace for a while. Eyes narrowed. Cam skimmed his hair backwards.
So you're in charge all of a sudden.
Looks to me like I'm the only one who kept his head above water. With this, Ethan turned and sauntered back toward the house. Together, Cam and Philip gripped the edge of the dock. They exchanged one long, hard look before Cam sighed.
We'll throw him in later,
he said. Accepting the apology, Philip nodded. He pulled himself up on the dock and sat, dragging off his ruined silk tie.
I loved him too, as much as you did, as much as anyone could. Yeah,
Cam yanked off his shoes.
I can't stand it.
It was a hard admission from a man he'd chosen to live on the edge.
I didn't want to be there today. I didn't want to stand there and watch him put him in the ground.
Yeah, you were there. That's all that would have mattered to him. Cam peeled off his socks, his tie, his jacket, but the chill of early spring.
Who told you about? Who said those things about that?
Grace. She'd been hearing talk and thought him best. That we knew what was being said. She told Ethan to me this morning. And she cried. Phil whipped her brow.
Still think I should have decked her.
Cam deeped his ruined shoes on the lawn.
I want to know who started this and why.
Have you looked at Seth, Cam? The wind was getting into his bones. That was why he suddenly wanted to shudder.
Sure, I looked at him.
Cam turned, headed for the house. Take a closer look, Philip murmured. When Cam walked into the kitchen 20 minutes later, warm and dry in a sweater and jeans, Ethan had coffee hot and whiskey ready. It was a big, family-style kitchen with a long wooden table in the center. The white countertop shoved
showed a bit of age, the wear and tear of use. There'd been talk a few years back of replacing the aging stove. Then Stella had gotten sick, and that had been the end of that. There was a big, shallow bowl on the table that Ethan had made in his junior year in high school wood shop. It had sat there since the day he brought it home, and was often filled with letters and notes and household flotsams, rather than the fruit it had been designed for. Three wide curtainless windows ranged along the back wall, opening the room up to the yard and the water beyond it. The cabinet doors were glass-fronted, and the dishes inside plain white stoneware, meticulously arranged, as would be, Cam thought, the contents of all the drawers. Stella had insisted on that. When she wanted a spoon, by God, she didn't want to search for one. But the refrigerator was covered with photos and newspaper clippings, notes, postcards, children's drawings, all haphazardly affixed with multicolored magnets, gave his heart a hitch to step into the room and know his parents wouldn't ever again be there. Coffee strong, Ethan continued. So's the whiskey. Take your choice.
I'll have both.
Cam poured a mug, added a shot of Johnny Walker to the coffee, and said,
you want to take a swing at me too?
I did. May again. Ethan decided he wanted his whiskey alone and neat, and poured a double. Don't much feel like it now. He stood by the window, looked out, the untouched whiskey in his hand. Maybe I still think you should have been here more the last few years. Maybe you couldn't be. It doesn't seem to matter now.
I'm not a waterman, Ethan. I do what I'm good at. That's what they expected.
Yeah. Couldn't imagine the need to run from the place that was home, and sanctuary, and love. But there was no point in questioning it, or in holding on to resentments, or, he admitted, casting blame. The place needs some work.
I noticed.
I should have made more time to come around and see the things. You always figure there's going to be plenty of time to go around, and there's not. The back steps are rotten out, need replacing. I kept meaning to. He turned as Philip came into the room. Grace has to work tonight, so she can't keep Seth occupied for more than a couple hours. You lay it out, Phil. It'll take me too long. All right. Philip poured coffee. He left the whiskey alone. Rather than sit, he leaned back against the counter. It seems a woman came to see Dad a few months back. She went to college, caused a little trouble that nobody paid much attention to at the time.
What kind of trouble?
Caused a scene in his office, a lot of shouting and crying on her part. Then she went to see the dean and tried to file sexual molestation charges against Dad.
That's a crock.
The dean apparently thought so too. Philip poured a second cup of coffee, this time brought it to the table. She claimed Dad had harassed and molested her while she was a student, but there was no record of her ever being a student at the college. Then she said she'd just been auditing his class because she couldn't afford full tuition, but nobody could verify that either. Dad's rep stood up to it, and it seemed to go away. It was pretty shaken, Ethan put in. He wouldn't talk to me about it, wouldn't talk to anybody. Then he went away for about a week. Told me he was going down to Florida to do some fishing. Came back with Seth.
You're trying to tell me people think the kid is, for Christ's sake, that he had something going on with his bimbo for waits, what, 10, 12 years to complain about it?
Nobody thought too much of it then, Philip put in. He had a history of bringing his race home, but then there was the money.
What money?
He wrote checks, one for $10,000, another for $5,000. And another for 10 over the last 3 months. All to Gloria DeLautner. Somebody at the bank noticed and mumbled to somebody else because Gloria DeLautner was the name of the woman who tried to hang him up on the sexual misconduct charges.
Why the hell didn't somebody tell me what was going on around here?
I didn't find out about the money until a few weeks ago. Ethan stared down at his whiskey and decided it would do more good inside than out. He downed it, hissed once. When I asked him about it, he just told me the boy was what was important. Not to worry. As soon as everything was settled, he'd explain. He asked me for some time, and he looked so defenseless. He don't know what it was like, seeing him scared and old and fragile. He didn't see him. He weren't here to see him. So he waited. Whiskey and guilt paired with resentment and grief to burn a hole inside him. And I was wrong. Shaking, Cam pushed back from him.
You think he was paying blackmail that he diddled some student a dozen years ago? Knocked her up, and now he's paying so she can keep quiet. So she handed over the kid for him to race.
I'm telling you what was and what I know. Ethan's voice was even. His eyes steady. Not what I know.
I don't know what I think, Philip said quietly, but I know Seth's got his eyes. You only have to look at him, Cam.
No way he fucked with a student. No way he cheated on my...
I don't want to believe it. Philip sat down.
But he was human. He could have made a mistake.
One of them had to be realistic, and he decided he was elected.
If he did, I'm not going to condone him for it. What we have to do is figure out how to do what he asks. We have to find a way to keep Seth. I can find out if you start adoption proceedings. They couldn't be final yet. We're going to need a lawyer. I want to find out more about this Gloria Delotner.
Deliberately, Cam unclenched his fist before he could use them on something or someone.
I want to know who the hell she is, where the hell she is.
Up to you. Philip shrugged his shoulders.
Personally, I don't want to get near her. What's this suicide crap?
Philip and Ethan exchanged glances. Then Ethan rose and walked to the kitchen drawer. He pulled it open, took out a large sealed bag. It hurt him to hold it, and he saw by the way Cam's eyes darkened that Cam recognized the worn green emblem shamrock keys ring as their father's. This was what was inside the car after the accident. He opened it, took out an envelope. The white paper was stained with dry blood. I guess somebody, one of the cops, tow truck operator, maybe one of the paramedics, looked inside and read the letter. They didn't trouble to keep it to themselves. It's from her. Ethan tapped out the letter, held it out to Cam. The Lautner, the postmark, Baltimore.
He was coming back from Baltimore.
With dread, Cam unfolded the letter. The handwriting was large. Loopy scrawl. Quinn, I'm tired of playing nickel and dime. You want the kid so bad, then it's time to pay for him. Meet me where you picked him up. We'll make it Monday morning. The block's pretty quiet then. 11 o'clock. Bring $150,000 in cash. Cash money, Quinn, and no discounts. You don't come through with every penny. I'm taking the kid back. Remember, I can pull the plug on the adoption anytime I want. $150,000's a pretty good bargain for a good-looking boy like Seth. Bring the money and I'm gone. You've got my word on it. Gloria.
She was selling him? Can't remember. Like he was up.
He stopped himself, looked sharply at Ethan as he remembered. Ethan had once been sold as well by his own mother to men who preferred young boys.
I'm sorry, Ethan.
I live with it, he said simply. Mom and Dad made sure I could. She's not going to get Seth back. Whatever it takes, she won't get her hands on him.
We don't know if he paid her.
He emptied his bank account here. Philip put him, from what I can tell, and I haven't gone over his papers in detail yet, he closed out his regular savings, cashed in his CDs. He only had a day to get the cash. That would have come to about $100,000. I don't know if he had 50 more, if he had time to liquidate any, if he did. She wouldn't have gone away. He'd have known that. Cam put the letter down, wiped his hands on his jeans as if to clean them.
So people are always whispering that he killed himself and what? Shame, panic, despair. He wouldn't have loved to get alone.
He didn't. Ethan moved to the coffin. He left him with us.
How the hell are we supposed to keep him?
Cam said again.
Who's going to let us adopt anybody?
We'll find a way. Ethan poured coffee. He added enough sugar to make Philip wince in reaction. He's ours now.
What the hell are we going to do with him?
Put him in skull, put a roof over his head, food in his belly, and trying to give him something what we were given. He brought the pot over, topped off Cam's cup. He got an argument.
Couple dozen, but none of them get to pass the fact that we gave our word.
We agree on that anyway. Frowning, Philip drumming his fingers on the table.
But we're left out one pretty vital point. None of us knows what Seth's gonna have to say about it. He might not want to stay here. Might not want to stay with us. You're just looking to complicate things as usual.
Cam complained.
Why wouldn't he?
Because he doesn't know you. He barely knows me. Philip looked at his company. The only one he spent time with is Ethan. Didn't spend all that much with me, Ethan admitted. I took him out on the boat a few times. He's got a quick mind, good hands. Doesn't have much to say for himself. But when he does, he's got a mouth on him. He spent some time with Grace. She doesn't seem to mind him.
Dad wanted him to stay.
Cam stated with a shrug.
These days.
He glanced over at the sound of a horn tooting. Three quick beeps. That'll be Grace dropping him back off on the way to Shiny's pub.
Shiny's.
Cam's bros shot up.
What's he doing down at Shiny's?
Making a living, I expect.
Ethan returned. Oh, yeah?
A slow grin spread.
Does he still have his waitresses dressed in those little skirts with the bows on the butt in the black fishnet stockings?
He does, Philip said with a long, wistful sigh.
He does indeed. Grace would fill out one of those outfits pretty well, I'd imagine.
She does, Philip smiled. She does indeed.
Maybe I'll just mosey down to Shiny's later.
Grace isn't one of your French models. Ethan pushed back from the table, took his mug and his annoyance to the sink. Back off.
Whoa.
Behind Ethan's back, Cam wiggled his bros to Philip.
Backing off, bro. Didn't know you had your eye aimed in that particular direction.
I doubt. She's a mother for Christ's sake.
I had a really fine time with the mother of two in Cancun last winter.
Cam remembered.
Her ex was swimming in oil. Olive oil. And all she got in the divorce settlement was a Mexican villa, a couple of cars, some trinkets in the divorce settlement. Settlement was a Mexican villa, a couple of cars, some trinkets, arts, and $2 million. I spent a memorial week consoling her, and the kids were cute from a distance with their nanny.
You're such a humanitarian, Cam, Philip told him.
Don't lie, I knew it.
They heard the front door slam and looked at each other.
Well, who talks to him?
Philip wanted to know. I'm no good at that kind of stuff. Ethan was already edging toward the back door. And I've got to go feed my dog.
Coward.
Cam muttered as the door shut at Ethan's back.
You bet. Me too.
Philip was up and moving. You get first crack. I've got those papers to go.
Wait just a damn minute.
But Philip was gone, and cheerfully telling Seth that Cameron wanted to talk to him. When Seth came to the kitchen door, the puppy scrambled at his heels. He saw Cam scowling as he poured more whiskey into his coffee. Seth stuck his hands in his pockets and lifted his chin. He didn't want to be there, didn't want to talk to anybody. At Grace's, he'd been able to just sit on her little stoop, be alone with his thoughts. Even when she'd come out for a little while and sat beside him with Aubrey on her knee, she let him be. Because she understood he wanted to be quiet. Now he had to deal with the man. He wasn't afraid of big hands and hard eyes. Wouldn't, couldn't let himself be afraid. He wouldn't care that they were going to kick him loose, toss him back like one of the runt fish Ethan pulled out of the bay. He could take care of himself. He wasn't worried. His heart scrambled in his chest like a mouse in a cage. What? The single word was right with defiance and challenge. Seth stood, his legs locked, and waiting for a reaction. Cam only continued to frown and sip his doctored coffee. With one hand, he absently stroked the puppy, who was trying violently to climb into his lap. He saw a scrawny boy wearing jeans still stiff and obviously new. A screw you sneer in Ray Quinn's eyes.
Sit down.
I can stand.
I didn't ask you what you could do. I told you to sit down.
Old Q, foolish, obediently plopped his fat butt on the floor and grinned. Boy and man stared at each other. The boy gave way first. It was the quick jerk of the shoulders that had Cam setting his mug down with a click. It was a Quinn gesture through and through. Cam took a moment to settle, trying to gather his thoughts, but they remained scattered and elusive. What the hell was he supposed to say to the boy?
You get anything to eat?
Seth watched him warily from under girlishly thick lashes.
Yeah, there was stuff. Ray, did he talk to you about things, plans for you?
The shoulders jerked again. I don't know.
He was working on adopting you, making it illegal. You knew about that?
He's dead.
Yeah.
Cam picked up his coffee again. Let the pain roll through.
He's dead.
I'm going to Florida. Seth burst out as the idea slammed into his mind. Cam sipped coffee, angled his head as if mildly interested.
Oh, yeah?
I got some money. I figured I'd leave in the morning, catch a bus south. You can't stop me.
You're okay.
More confident now. Cam leaned back in his chair.
I'm bigger than you. What do you plan to do in Florida?
I can get work. I can do lots of things.
Pick some pockets, sleep on a bench.
Maybe? Cam nodded. That had been his plan when his destination had been Mexico. For the first time, he thought he might be able to connect with the boy after all.
I guess you can't drive yet.
I could if I had to.
Harder to boost a car these days unless you've got some experience. And you need to be mobile to keep ahead of the cops. Florida's a bad idea.
That's where I'm going. Seth set his jaw.
No, it isn't.
You're not sending me back. Seth lurched up from the chair, his thin frame vibrating with fear and rage. The sudden move and shout sent the puppy racing fearfully from the room. You got no hold over me. You can't make me go back.
Back where?
To her. I'll go right now. I'll get my stuff and I'm gone. If you think you can stop me, you're full of shit. Can't recognize the stance. Brace for a blow, but ready to fight back.
You knock you around.
That's none of your fucking business.
Right, murder my fucking business. You head for that door?
He added as Seth shifted to the balls of his feet.
I'll just doll you right back.
Cam only sighed when Seth made his dash. Even as he caught him 3 feet before the front door, he had to give Seth credit for speed. And when he caught the boy around the waist, took the backhanded fist on his already tender jaw, he gave him credit for strength. Get your goddamn hands off me, you son of a bitch. I'll kill you if you touch me. Grimly, Cam dragged Seth into the living room, pushed him into a chair, and held him there with their faces closed. If it had just been anger he saw in the boy's eyes, or defiance, he wouldn't have cared. But what he saw was raw terror.
You got balls, kid. Now try to develop some brains to go with them. If I want sex, I want a woman. Understand me?
He couldn't speak. All he knew when that hard muscular arm had wrapped around him was that this time he wouldn't be able to escape. This time he wouldn't be able to fight free and run.
There's nobody here who's gonna touch you like that ever.
Without realizing it, Cam had gentled his voice. His eyes remained dark, but the hardness was gone.
If I lay hands on you, the worst it means is I might try to knock some sense into you. You got that?
I don't want you to touch me. Seth managed. His breath was gone. Panic sweat slicked his skin like oil. I don't like being touched.
Okay, fine. You see where I put you.
Cammy's back, then pulled over a footstool and sat. Since Foolish was now shivering in terror, Cam plucked him up and dumped him in Seth's lap.
We got a problem.
Cam began and prayed for inspiration on how to handle.
I can't watch you 24 hours a day, and if I could, I'm damned if I would. Take off for Florida, I'm gonna have to go find you and haul you back. That's really gonna piss me off.
Because the dog was there, Seth stroked him, gaining comfort while giving it. What do you care where I go?
I can't say I do, but Ray did, so you're gonna have to stay.
Stay? It was an option Seth had never considered. Certainly hadn't allowed himself to believe. Here? When you sell the house?
Who's selling this house?
I... Seth broke off. Seth, how did you say too much? People figured you would.
People figured wrong. Nobody's selling this house.
Surprised Cam just how firm his feelings were on that particular point.
I don't know how we're going to manage it yet. I'm still working on that. But in the meantime, you better get this into your head. You're staying put.
Which meant Cam realized with a jolt, so was he. It appeared his luck was still running bad.
We're stuck with each other, kid. For the next little while, at least.
End of chapter 2. That's end of chapter 2 of Nora Roberts' book, Sea Swept. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, that's cool. If not, that's cool too. Later, Gators.